Welcome to the series related to object oriented programming lab, and here we will study about object oriented programming. Okay, and mostly you know about object oriented programming as C++. Okay, and there is other languages related to the object oriented programming, but basically we will learn here related to C++. Okay. And earlier I have given you, and this is the special class for diploma students, okay, for late admissions. And already I have given some resources, this slide also, and resources like virtual lab, okay, from IITs. So you can go and practice for C, okay, only C language there. And here I will give you another resource, online resource. So you can go there and you can learn about more about object oriented programming and C++, and you can compile and make your own program on those sites. So you can virtually make your program and virtually run your program on those sites. Okay. So let's start with our slide. Okay, so here is the syllabus. You can see, simply understand the basics of C++ library and other 12 assignments here. You can see. Okay, so start with our first topic, and mostly maybe the time is short, but I will try to complete most of the concept. I will try to complete here. Okay, so here you know about the basics about compiler. Okay, so before that you can see that there is a language C, okay, and there is a C++ is the superset of C. Okay, so you can run your C program into C++ also. And again, C++ language architecture, here you can see source code, compiler, okay, then object code, it converts, compiler converts object code, then it goes to linker, okay, for linking resources, okay, memory, and then it's converted into machine code, okay. And again, you can see here, after that, last, as machine code runs in OS using CPU. Okay, so there are lots of things in C++. Okay, there are variables, C++ libraries, data input and output, so it makes the C++ more user friendly. And here you can see the library related part, C++ library. So C++ standard library can be categorized into two parts, C++ library, okay, and the standard function library, and second one is object oriented class library. So standard library function, standard function library, so it can consist of general purpose and standalone functions that are not part of any class. And the function library, this function library is inherited from C language. Okay, and the second one is object oriented class library, and this is a collection of classes and associated functions, okay, mostly related to object oriented. Then again, in standard function library, the library divided into several categories. Here you can see input output, string and character handling, mathematical, time, date and localization, dynamic allocation and miscellaneous. Okay, and again, the object oriented class library, again this you can simply say this library defines an extensive set of classes that provide support for number of common activities including input output, strings and numeric processing. And it includes several classes like standard C++ input output classes, string class, numeric classes, STL container classes, STL algorithms, then STL function objects, okay, then STL iterators, STL allocators, okay, and then localization library. Again, the structure. So you know about the structure in C, and here again the structure. Sorry, 1 minute. Okay, structure. So here structures are arrays are used mostly arrays are used to store large set of data, okay, and manipulate them. But the disadvantage is that all the elements stored in an array are to be to be of the same data type, okay. And when we need a collection of different data items of different data types such as integer, float, so we can use a structure for that. And structure can be seen as data type composed of different data type. Okay. Then here are some basic concepts related to OOPs, object oriented programming. Okay. So there are objects in program, classes, several classes, data abstractions, encapsulations, inheritance, polymorphism, dynamic binding, okay, and message passing. So these are the basic you can say concepts and features are also related to object oriented programming, okay. So we will study about one by one about this, okay. So first we go for C++ basic input output. So here you can see a demo program include IOStream, okay, and you have to use a namespace standard, okay, using namespace standard to support this in IOStream, okay. And I will show you the details more about this namespace, okay, later on. So then after that initializing this including this input outputs header files, you have to go for int main program, okay. So simply print the string enclosed in double quotes. So we have a output library cout, and there is the symbol related to cout, okay. And this is the again this is the related to operator overloading, okay. This is part related to operator overloading, okay. So we will discuss this later on. And you have to print this. This is C++ programming, okay. And again the main program returns some values. So we have a return null value here, 0, okay, and then we will close it here, this curly braces, start from curly braces and close is here, okay. Then simply how does this program work? So simply first the IOStream header files, okay, include the IOStream header files that allows us to display output, okay. And the cout object is defined inside the standard namespace, okay. And to use standard namespace, we used the using namespace std statement, okay. So you know about the namespace right now, it is related to the IOStream input output objects, okay. And every C++ program start with the main function. The code execution begin from the start of the main function, okay. And cout is an object that prints the string inside quotation marks, and it is followed by the symbol here, cout related operator, okay. Then if we don't include the using namespace std, the statement we need to use std double you can say this is the symbol related to colon, okay. So colon used for standard colon cout instead of cout, okay. So here is the demo program, okay. Here is the standard. If you you are not using namespace std, okay, if you are not including the using namespace std, then you can use this standard colons cout, okay, double colons here, okay. And this is also a example of operator overloading. Then special notes here, the to print the numbers and character variable we use the same cout object but without using quotation marks, okay. And the endl manipulator is used to insert a new line, okay. And each output is displayed in a new line. Okay, that's due to this new line operator. Okay, NL manipulator, and this symbols operator can be used more than once if we want to print different variables. Okay, this is related to cout, and for cin you have to use greater than symbols. Okay, twice. Then strings and so on in our single statements. Okay. So here is the input related C++ input. So in C++, Cin takes deformated input from the standard input devices such as the keyboard, and we use the Cin object along with this greater than double operator. Okay, operator for taking input. Okay, and if we don't include the using name spread, again we have to use this std double colon Cin instead of simple Cin. Then C++ classes and objects. So in C++, rather than creating separate variables and function, we can also wrap these related data and function in a single space by creating the objects. Okay, and this programming paradigm is known as object-oriented programming. So in C++, a class is a blueprint for the object. Okay, we can think of a class as a sketch prototype of a house. Okay, for example, and it contains all the details about the floors, doors, windows, etc. And based on this description, we build the house, and house is the object. Okay, and simply create a class. Then a class is defined in C++ using keyword class followed by the name of the class. And then the body of the class is defined inside the curly brackets. Okay. So simply the C++ object. So when a class is defined, only the specification for the object is defined, no memory or storage is allocated. And then to use the data and access function defined in the class, we need to create objects. Okay, so syntax to define object in C++, here you can see class name, object variable name. Okay, simply to define the object, and we can create objects of a class in any function of the program. And we can also create objects of a class within the class itself or in other classes. Then C++ accesses data members and member functions. So we can access the data members and member functions of a class by using a dot operator. Okay, so we will see how these data members are accessed and member functions are accessed. So here we have a dynamic memory allocations, okay, and function overloading, okay, array of objects, constructor and destructors. Okay, so here is the book related to this. Okay, C++ functions overloading, beginnersbook.com. You can go and check more about these details. Okay, so simply start with first memory model, C++ memory model. So C++ memory model differs from the Java memory model. Okay, in C++, memory comes from two places, the runtime stack and the memory heap. So in C++, when you invoke a function, a chunk of memory, okay, so okay, now you can see. So when you invoke a function of chunk of memory called an activation record or stack frame, is allocated that includes all necessary things for that function. Okay, and memory for the parameters, memory for locals, address of where to return when the function finishes, etc. And this memory is pushed onto the runtime stack, a collection of these activation records. Again, when the function finishes, the record is popped off the stack, so the memory is released, and so it can be reused. And in C++, when you dynamically allocate memory using new operator, the memory comes off the memory heap. Okay, so now static objects. Okay, so for static object persistent, it remains in memory. Okay, until the end of the program, so it persists always until the end of the until the you can say program ends. Okay, and then file scope, so it can be seen only writing a file when it is defined. Okay, visibility, if it is defined within a function block, its scope is limited to that function and block, and it cannot be accessed outside of the function and block. Okay, and then class, class is static member, exists as member of the class rather than as an instance in each object of the class. Okay, and this keyword is not available in static member functions, so such functions may access only static data members. So there is only a single instance of each static data member of the entire class. And then a static data members, okay, a class variable, and a non-static data members, instance variables. So static member functions, it can only access static member data or other static member functions, while non-static member functions can access all data member of the class. So there are static and non-static member functions and data members. Again, some definitions. So here is the variable declared static within the body of function, maintain its value between invocation of the functions. Okay, and a variable declared static within a module is accessible by all functions within that module. And however, it is not accessible by functions from other modules. Okay, and the static members exist as members of the class rather than as an instance in each object of the class. So there is only a single instance of each static data member for the entire class. And in case of non-static member functions, it can access all data members of the class, static and non-static both. And the static member function can only operate on the static data members. Okay. And the C function declared static within a module may only be called by other functions within that module. Then static objects. So static objects is an object that persists from the time it constructed until the end of the program, we already know. And so the stack and heap objects are excluded. Okay, but global objects, object at namespace scope, objects declared static inside class and functions, and object declared at file scopes are included in static objects. So static objects are destroyed when the program stops running. Again, more about static storage. So variables defined outside a function or by using keyword static have static storage duration, and they persist for the entire running time of a program. Okay, and these variables can be classified as three groups in terms of linkages. Here you can see external linkage, internal linkage, and no linkage. Okay, and again, since the static variables stay the same throughout the life of the program, they are easy to deal with for the memory system, and they are allocated in a fixed block of memory. So here you can see the example of static variable with different durations. Okay, a sample code here. Here all the static variable persist until program terminates, and the variable D has local scope and no linkage. Okay, and so D is equal to 4 here, and it's not used outside of function F. Okay, void function F, but C remains in memory even when the function F is not being executed. So we have here is the C static variable here, int C is equal to 3, and by saying that C is static, we are saying that we want to allocate it once and only once at some point before the first time that function F is called. And again, that we do not want to deallocate it as long as our program runs. Okay, both A and B can be accessed from the point of declaration. So here is the A and B until the end of the file, but A can be used in other files because it has external linkage. These are the external variable and these are the internal variables. Okay. Then static duration variables have the following initialization characteristics. Okay, and uninitialized static variable set to 0. Okay, and a static variable can be initialized only within with a constant expression. So here you can see the demo program. There is a x, okay, x set to 0, y is equal to 50, it's a literal constant, and z is equal to size of int, so size of int, okay. Then we have a double z is equal to 10 into x, so not allowed, okay. It is because we cannot use this double z, and x is not constant, okay, because we have no value related to x here. It's set initially set to 0, and then int main, okay, and this, okay. Now we have constant and external. So constant in C++ gives a little bit of use to the default storage classes. While a global variable has external linkage by default, a constant global has internal linkage by default. So in other words, we can say C++ treats a global constant definition as if the static has been used, as in the following code. So here is the example related to this constant. So constant int a is equal to 10. Okay, so the constant int a is equal to 10 becomes static constant int a is equal to 10. However, if a global constant had external linkage as regular variables do, the constant declaration would be an error, because we can define a global variable in one file only. And in other words, only one file can contain the preceding declaration, and other files have to provide references declaration using the extern keyword. And note that the only the declaration without the extern can initialize value. And if we want to make a constants have external linkage, we can use the extern keyword to override the default internal linkage, like here extern constant int a is equal to 20. So we have override a is equal to 10 here, and we should use the extern keyword to declare the constant in all files that use the constant. And that's the difference between regular external variable and constant. And for regular external variable, we don't use the keyword extern when we define a variable, but we use extern in other files using that variable. So here is the extern. Extern declaration does not define the variable unless it is also initialized in the same statement. So here are the two examples, extern, okay. And for extern C, please, you can see this extern C, okay. And then static storage and dynamic allocation, okay. So dynamic memory is controlled by the new and delete operator, and note by scope and linkage rules. So the dynamic memory can be allocated from one function and freed from another functions. And although the storage scheme don't apply to dynamic memory, then do apply to automatic and static pointer variable used to keep track of dynamic memory. So here is a simple code, int pointer ptr is equal to new int 10, okay. So the 40 bytes of memory allocated by new remains in memory until the delete frees it, and but the pointer ptr passes from existence when the function containing this declaration terminates, okay. And again, if we want to have the 40 bytes of allocated memory available from another function, we need to pass or return its address to that function. So on other hand, if we declare pointer ptr with external linkage, the ptr pointer will be available by using here extern int point star pointer ptr, sorry. And however, if a statement that use new set ptr has to be in a function because static storage variable can only be initialized with a constant expression. As here you can see a sample demo, int star ptr selection with non-constant not allowed here. So int star ptr is equal to new int 10, okay. And again, you can call here it invoke this pointer here, ptr is equal to new int 10. Then static class members. So static members exist as member of the class rather than as an instance in each object of the class, okay. So this keyword is not available in a static member function, and such functions may access only static data members, and there is a single instance of each static data member for entire class, which should be initialized usually in the source file that implements the class member functions. And because of the member is initialized outside the class definition, we must use fully qualified name when we initialize it. So sample is here class name, okay, double colon static member name is equal to value. Here is the demo, okay, car ID 100. So we have a car CPP, car. Code initialize the static ID member 200. Note again that we cannot initialize the static member variable inside the class declaration, and that's because the declaration is a description of how memory is to be allocated, but it doesn't allocate memory, and we allocate and initialize memory by creating an object using that format. So there are lots of things about the static. You can go through the slides. Okay, and here is the simple example car CPP. Okay, now we have static member functions. So non-static members cannot be used as default arguments, and the following code shows the non-static member cannot be used as default argument. So here is the again, you can see the code. Okay, here is a struct foo member state. Okay, foo member, and we call here. Okay, 911. And this is the wrong. Okay, this won't comply. Okay, here. So simple static member functions. So already we know about some short details. So we complete here about the static member functions. So in static member function can only access static member data, static member functions and data function outside the class. And we must take note that to use static member function in the same manner as non-static member functions. As non-static member function can access all of the above including static data member. Then we must first understand the concept of static data while learning the context of static function. So it is possible to declare a data member of a class as static irrespective of it being a public or private type in class definitions. Again, if a data is declared as static, then the static data is created and initialized by only once, and non-static data members are created again and again. And for each separate object of the class, the static data is created and initialized only once. So in the concept of static data, all objects of class in static functions share the variable, and this applies to all objects of the class. So in case of non-static member functions, it can only be called only after instantiating the class as an object, and this is not the case with static member functions. Static member functions can be called even when a class is not instantiated. And then a static member function cannot have access to this pointer of the class. Okay, so non-static member functions can be declared as a virtual, but care must be taken not to declare a static member function as virtual. Now we will study about features. Like first is here inheritance. So inheritance is a mechanism of acquiring the features and behavior of a class by another class. And the class whose members are inherited is called the base class, and the class that inherits those members is called the derived class. So inheritance is the important feature. Inheritance implements the ISA relationship, is a relationship. And for example, mammal is a animal, so dog is a mammal. Okay, hence dog is the animal as well. So there are different types of inheritance. So OOPS supports 6 different types of inheritance. So you can see here single inheritance, multi-level inheritance, multiple inheritance, multipath inheritance, hierarchical inheritance, and hybrid inheritance. Okay. So here is the view about those inheritance: single inheritance, multi-level inheritance, and then multiple inheritance, multipath inheritance, then hierarchical inheritance, and hybrid inheritance. So you can see that the class A goes to class B. So here again there are 3 levels. Okay, then again here class C contains class A and class B. Okay, the features related to through those class A and B. Okay, same here there is a class A, so B inherits. Okay, A and also C inherited. Again, this D inherits B and C. So the indirectly it go inherits the class A. Okay, so you can study more about those inheritance. So here is the single inheritance already we can see. So I will not complete this inheritance related details because you can simply see how the different inheritance inherits their different classes. Okay, so simply I skip these details here. Okay, we will see more about inheritance during code or example. Okay, so the here you can see the advantage of inheritance. So it reduces code redundancy, provide code reusability, reduces source code size and improves code readability. Code is easy to manage and divided into parents and child classes. Okay, support code extensibility by overriding the base class functionality within child classes. Okay, then disadvantage of inheritance. So inheritance, base class and child class both are tightly coupled. Okay, hence if you change the code of a parent class, it will affect all the child classes. And in a class hierarchy, many data members remain unused and the memory allocated to them is not utilized. So hence it affects the performance of your program if you have not implemented inheritance correctly. Then virtual function in C++, it is important. So we will go for this. So virtual function is a member function which is declared within a base class and is redefined, overridden by a derived class. When you refer to a derived class object using a pointer or reference to the base class, you can call a virtual function for that object and executes the derived class version of the function. Okay, then virtual functions ensure that the correct function is called for an object and regardless of the type of reference or pointer used for that function call, and they are mainly used to achieve runtime polymorphisms. Okay, that's this is another features of OOPS. And functions are declared within a virtual keyword in base class and the resolving of function call is done at runtime. So rules for virtual functions. So virtual function cannot be static and also cannot be a friend functions of another class. Virtual functions should be accessed using pointer reference of base class type to achieve runtime polymorphism. And the prototype of virtual functions should be same in base as well as derived class. And they are always defined in base class and overridden in derived class, and it is not mandatory for derived class to override. So in that case, base class version of function is used, and a class may have virtual destructor, but it cannot have a virtual constructor. We will see this constructor and destructor. Okay, so here are some demo code. So I will show you, give you resources so you can go there and see more demo codes. Okay, and then you can make your own code. So next is function overriding in C++. So function overriding is a feature that allows us to have the same function in child class which is already present in the parent class. So a child class inherits the data members and member function of parent class. And but when you want to override a functionality in the child class, then you can use function overriding, and it is like creating a new version of an old function in the child class. So here is the demo. Okay, you can see a class base class here. Okay, the function of a parent class, and then another derived class, public base class. Okay, function of child class. So in main you can call here derived class object equal to derived class. So it's give you the object dot DSP, DISP, so okay, return 0. Okay, so this is the main features related to the virtual and other OOPS related concepts. Now I will show you a resource where you can find more about object-oriented programming and C++. So we will go to there. I will close. I am closing this slide right now here. Okay, so there are lots of resources available on internet. So here is a simple C++.com, the C++ resource network. You can find out tutorials, references, okay, operators, statements, flow, and brief descriptions. So by clicking here, and again there are sample programs with theory. Okay, so you can read the theory, okay, simple, and here you can go for tutorials or history related to C++, references and articles. Okay, so simply we will go to here C++ language, so for tutorials. Okay, and then here are some basic theory about C++. So there are basics of C++, okay, and like structure of a program, variable types, constant, operator, basic input output, okay, then program structure, statement and flow, control, function overloads, templates, name visibility, and then compound of data types, arrays, characters, sequence, pointers. So you can go and then learn more about this C++. Okay, so simply we will go to here, like first structure of a program. So here you can see a demo program, okay, and here is the output. So simply you can simply go edit and run. Okay, so here it opens a new cell, okay, C++ online cell. Okay, so simply here are the versions, okay, related to the C++, and then simply you have to run from here. Okay, so it goes and run because there is no code. So 1 minute. So I will show you a different 1 minute. This is simple code, so I will copy from this code because the system is not copying. So simply copy here and then, okay, now it gives okay here. So we do not have to copy here. Okay, simply run this here. Okay, why this giving this thing? Okay, this is the output. So simply we have to run and it gives the output. So we will see more examples, like we go for dynamic memory. Okay, so here is the dynamic operator new, already we know about this. Okay, so there are some demo codes. Okay, for this one is the complete code. Okay, so simply go here. Okay, so it's give you, okay, here you can edit this code again. Okay, you can make your own code here. Okay, then you can choose the versions, warning style, okay, optimization levels and standard input. Okay, so simply run from this and this compile and then execute. So how many numbers would you like to type? So simply 10. Okay, so enter number. So simply I go give this request here. Okay, 17, 18 and 19 and then 20 and then 21. Okay, so it gives output like this. Okay, so this is the resource. You can go and learn more about this things. Okay, practice about practicing the C++ here. There are other classes related codes here. You can go and then learn more about these classes. Here is the complete code for rectangle. So you can go and assign, use this code to make your own assignments. Here is the constructor. And construction function is a regular member function, and with a name that matches the class name and without any return type and not even void. So here is the constructor. This is the constructor. And again, this is called here with the rectangle class. So here is the output. So simply we go and run here. So here is the code, and simply we go run 1 minute, close. This is the output here, you can see. So again, there is the constructor. Overloading, then in from initialization, construction member, pointer to classes. So this is related to likewise, you can go for more classes. Overloading, operator overloading. So all details are here, and you can use this resource to do your program. Like virtual lab. And one more thing is, already I have given resources, I think. So you can start using this resource and try to do program here, virtually, or try to run those programs here, available programs from here, and then again I will provide some more program on Google Classroom, so you can use those programs for C++, and you can write those programs into your lab file. So that's all for today. So here I will close this session. So use this resource for your program, and try to understand the concept related to C++ language. So thank you. We will end here. We are going to end here. So class is over here.